In the last session, we have finished with the classification of the semi-solid dosage form. In the today's session, we are going to discuss the transdermal permeation of drugs. So before discussing the dermal permeation of drugs, there is a need to understand the anatomy and physiology of the skin. Without understanding the anatomy and physiology of skin, it is very difficult to understand how the drug it is going to be permeated through the skin. There are so many different mechanisms are there by which the drug it is going to be permeated. So let us move towards the anatomy and physiology of the skin. As the skin, it is the one of the most accessible organ of the human body. It is having an average surface area which is a 2 meters square and approximately the few millimeter in the thickness. So the surface area which is available for the skin, it is approximately 2 meters square with a few millimeter of the thickness. It is going to receive approximately 1/3 of circulating blood. So whatever the cardiac output is there, from that cardiac output, 1/3 blood reaches to the skin. Physiologically, the skin is served as a barrier against physical and chemical attacks and protects the vital organs from the microbial invasions. So the skin, it is going to protect the body, isn't it? It is going to protect the organs from the microbial invasions. Apart from these, there are several other functions are also there, and one of the function of skin is the first line of defense of human body. The major functions of skin, which includes the protection, then water level maintenance, and the body temperature regulation. Apart from these functions, there are so many other functions are also there, which are related with the sensory, then mechanical injury protection, radiation injury prevention, then physical barrier, then thermoregulation, then fluid loss prevention, and the antimicrobial property. So this is the general introduction about the skin. Moving towards the anatomy of the skin. Look at the figure. You will see here the human skin, which comprises the 3 major layers. The outermost layer, it is known as the epidermis. The middle layer, it is known as the dermis. And the innermost layer, that is known as the hypodermis. The outermost layer, epidermis, it is having a thickness of approximately 0.07 to 0.15 mm and comprises the various strata like stratum corneum, stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, stratum spinosum, and stratum germinativum. Okay, so there are approximately 4 to 5 layers are present in the epidermis. The outermost layer, that is known as the stratum corneum, shown in the figure. So whatever the outermost layer is there, that is known as the stratum corneum, which is a dead keratinized cell. Then the dermis. So here, this is the dermis, which is having a thickness 1 to 4 mm. And it comprises the blood vessels, then the nerves, sebaceous glands, sweat glands, mast cells, and the macrophages. So here you will find, here it's a hair follicle, then these are the sebaceous glands, these are the sweat glands along with the nerve. And the hypodermis, it is the innermost layer, or it is also known as the subcutaneous tissue, which acts as a fastener for skin to the underlying surface and the fat storage. So the skin comprises the 3 major layers. Very first one, that is the epidermis, second one dermis, and third one hypodermis. The epidermis comprises approximately 5 strata, that is the stratum corneum, stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, stratum spinosum, and stratum germinativum. The outermost layer, that is known as the stratum corneum, and whatever the remaining strata are there, that is known as the viable epidermis. The stratum corneum, it is having a thickness of approximately 15 to 18 micrometer. And whatever the viable epidermis is there, it is having a thickness of 150 to 180 micrometer. So let us see the details of the epidermis. So look at the figure again. The transsectional view of the human skin. So here the outermost layer I have shown, that is known as the stratum corneum, which is having a thickness of 15 to 20 micrometer. And the viable epidermis, it is having a thickness of 130 to 180 micrometer. So the epidermis, it is the outermost layer of the skin, and it is having a varying thickness approximately 0.8 mm on the palms of the hands and soles of the feet. The maximum thickness of epidermal layer, which is on the palms and soles, which is approximately 0.8 mm. It consists of multilayered regions of epithelial cells and the viable epidermis. So the outermost, that is stratum corneum, and the viable epidermis, which comprises the remaining strata, which we have discussed in the earlier slide, which is having a thickness 130 to 180 micrometer. So it consists of multilayered regions of epithelial cells, and viable epidermis is often referred to as a epidermal layers below the stratum corneum. So the below the stratum corneum, whatever the layers are there, epidermal layers are there, that is known as the viable epidermis. The cellular content of viable epidermis, it consists of predominantly the keratinocytes, approximately 95% of cells, with the other cells of epidermal layer, including the melanocytes, which is not shown on the figure, then the Langerhans cells. Here you will find the Langerhans cells and the Merkel cells, which are again not shown in the figure. So the epidermal layer or the viable epidermis, it comprises of the 95% of the keratinocytes with the other cell layers like melanocytes, Langerhans cells, and the Merkel cells. So let us see the further details of the epidermis. So as I have said, that the outermost layer, that is known as the stratum corneum, and which is the main barrier for the permeation of the drug, because of it is a dead keratinized layer. So this is the outermost layer, that is known as the stratum corneum. On below the stratum corneum, there is the presence of the stratum lucidum, then stratum granulosum, then stratum spinosum, stratum basali. You will find some other cells which I have discussed, that is the lamellar granules, then the keratinocytes, then the Merkel cells. The stratum corneum, it is in a direct contact with the external environment, and its barrier properties may be partly related to its very high density, that is 1.4 gram per centimeter cube in the dry state, and its low hydration of about 15 to 20%. So the stratum corneum, it is going to act as a main barrier for the permeation of drug, as it is having a high density, that is 1.4 gram per centimeter cube, and the low hydration or the low moisture content. The cells of the stratum corneum are composed of mainly insoluble keratin, so it comprises of 70% insoluble keratin and 20% of the lipids. So what are in the stratum corneum? It is in associated with the keratin in the corneocytes. Okay, so this is about the epidermis. Let us see the dermis. Dermis layer, dermal layer, it is present just below the viable epidermis. So it is having a thickness of 2000 micrometer, which is average, which is shown on the figure. And the thickness, it is ranging between 1 to 4 millimeter and consists of 70% of collagenous and elastin fibers which gives the strength and elasticity to the skin. Whatever the strength and the elasticity which is present on the skin, it is due to the elastin and the collagenous tissue which is, or the fibers which are present in the dermal layer. Generally, the dermis comprises the blood vessels which provides the nutrient for both the dermis and the epidermis. You will see here the some blood vessels which are shown in the dermal layer, isn't it? It also contains the skin appendages like a sweat glands and a, that is the apocrine and eccrine glands, then sebaceous glands and the hair follicles. The main role of dermis is to nurture the epidermis, as it comprises the some blood vessels which are going to provide the nutrients to the epidermal layer. So this is about the dermis. Moving towards the hypodermis. So hypodermis, it is the innermost layer, that is a subcutaneous tissue. So it is the deepest layer of the skin and consists of a network of fat cells. It is the contact layer between the skin and the underlying tissue of the body, such as muscles and bones. The major function of hypodermis are protection against the physical shock, then heat insulation, and support and conductance of vascular and neural signals of skin. Hypodermis resistant fat cells account for approximately 50% of body fat, with the other predominant cells of the hypodermis consisting of fibroblasts and the macrophages. So the anatomically and physiologically, the skin comprises the three major layers, that is the epidermis, dermis, and the hypodermis. Epidermis comprises the stratum corneum and the viable epidermis. The stratum corneum is the main barrier which is going to affect the permeation of drug into the skin. Moving towards the skin appendages. So look at the figure. So here you will find the, I've shown here some skin appendages. So it comprises here, it's a eccrine gland. This is the apocrine gland. Then here is the sebaceous gland. These are the hair shafts and the hair follicle. Apocrine gland, which is opened into the hair duct. So the skin appendages comprises the three main glands, that is the sweat glands, then the hair follicles, and the sebaceous gland. The very first one, the sweat gland, they aid in a heat control and secrete the sweat. The main function of the sweat gland to secrete the sweat, and which is going to help to maintain the temperature of body. You got the point. There are two types of the sweat glands are there. Very first one is the eccrine sweat gland. So here I have shown the eccrine sweat gland, and second one, that is the apocrine sweat gland. So the eccrine sweat gland, it is approximately 2 to 5 million, which produces the sweat and secrete drug, proteins, antibodies, and antigens. Apocrine sweat gland, which develops at a phyllosebaceous follicle in the armpit. It's a milky or oily secretion, may be colored, and contains the proteins, lipids, lipoproteins, and saccharides. So the bacteria metabolize these odorless secretion to give the characteristic human smell. So this is about the apocrine sweat gland. So this is the apocrine sweat gland, and which is opened into the hair follicle, right? So the hair follicle, which develop all over the skin except the red part of lips, palms, and sole. So the except lips, palms, and sole, you will find the hair follicles all over the body. One or more sebaceous gland. So here is a sebaceous gland, and sometimes the sweat gland, that is apocrine, which is opened into the hair follicle. So this is about the hair follicle. The sebaceous gland, it is the most numerous on the face, forehead in the ear, and this produces the sebum, which comprises mainly the glycerides, free fatty acids, cholesterol, cholesterol esters, wax esters, and the skin. As we are discussing the skin appendages, because it is going to bypass the stratum corneum, but you will find whatever these glands are there, they are directly opened on the skin. So let us move towards the mechanism of dermal penetration of drug. So there are two major mechanisms are there. Very first one, that is known as the transepidermal, and second one, that is known as the transappendageal. So the transepidermal, it is furthermore divided into the intercellular and the intracellular, and transappendageal, that is through the sweat glands and the hair follicle. So as I have said that the transepidermal, it is divided into the intercellular, that is known as the paracellular, and the intracellular, that is known as the transcellular. So the intercellular, that is the across the lipid matrix, and it is accessible to non-polar molecules, that is a lipid molecule. Am I right? Lipid molecules gets easily permeated through the skin by the paracellular or the intercellular route, whereas the intracellular route, it is across keratinized cells. It is accessible to the polar molecules, or you can say it as a hydrophilic molecule, isn't it? The transappendageal route, that is through the sweat glands or hair follicle, that is across hair follicles and sweat ducts, and it is again accessible to the polar molecule. So the lipophilic drugs are going to be permeated through the skin via intercellular or the paracellular route, whereas the polar molecules, which are going to be permeated through the skin via intracellular route or the transappendageal route. So there are two major routes are there, that is a transepidermal route and the transappendageal route. Transepidermal, that is intercellular and intracellular, and the transappendageal, that is through sweat glands or the hair follicle. You got the point? So let us see the details of the transepidermal route. Again, look at the figure. Very first one, that is a intracellular route. It is also known as the transcellular route. Blue line. Suppose that we have applied the formulation over here via transcellular route or intracellular route, the drug, it is going to be permeated into the skin. That is through the corneocyte sites, that is also known as the bricks, that is a terminally differentiated keratinocytes, which allows the transport of hydrophilic or the polar solute. So here you will find the magnifying image of this part, that is the corneocyte, that is here you will see the keratin, and these are the in. So here is a keratin which is present, and through which the drug, it is going to be permeated from one side to the another side. So the drug entering the skin via the intracellular route pass through the corneocyte, as I have said. So corneocytes containing highly hydrated keratin, which provides an aqueous environment from which the hydrophilic drug can pass. So only the hydrophilic drugs which are going to cross this barrier by the intracellular or the transcellular route. Here there is a presence of the corneocytes. Whatever the pink color is there, this is the lipid layer, isn't it? Lipid layer. And through this lipid layer, corneocyte, the drug is going to cross this superficial layers, and it is going to be reached into the systemic circulation, isn't it? So the intracellular pathway requires not only the partitioning into and the diffusion through the keratin bricks, but also into and across the intercellular lipids. So between the two cells, the lipids are present. So initially the drug reaches into the lipid layer, then it reaches to the corneocyte bricks or cell, then furthermore again into the lipid layer, again into the cell. Likewise, the drug is going, it is going to be absorbed into the systemic circulation. So this is about the intracellular route. Let us move towards the intercellular route. So the intercellular route, look at the here blue line. It is also known as the paracellular route. So this is the route that is known as the paracellular route. So fully through this lipid matrix layer, through this lipid matrix layer zigzag, the drug, it is going to be crossed or reached into the systemic circulation. It is not going to cross any cell barrier, any specific cell. Through the lipid matrix only, the drug, it is going to be reached into the systemic circulation. So here, this is the lipid matrix, and this is a magnification of this figure. So you will find here, this is the lipid layer, and this is the aqueous region, isn't it? And you will find here the lipid bilayer. Unless and until the drug is having a biphasic solubility, it is not going to cross this barrier, or it is not going to absorb through the paracellular. So the transport via intercellular passes allows diffusion of lipophilic or non-polar solutes through the continuous lipid matrix. That is known as the lipid matrix, that is known as the mortar, isn't it? And in the previous slide, we have seen the bricks. Am I right? So this route is a significant obstacle for two reasons. Very first reason, that is the interdigitating nature of the corneocytes yield a tortoise pathway. So whatever this zigzag is there, that is known as the tortoise pathway for the intercellular drug permeation, which is in contrast to relatively direct path of the transcellular route. That is, direct path means this is a straight line. And the intercellular domain is a region of alternating structured bilayer. So there is a structured bilayer in there. So it is going to act as a significant obstacle for permeation of the drug. So the consequently, drug must sequentially partition into and diffuse through repelled aqueous and lipid domain. And this route is generally accepted as the most common pathway for small uncharged molecules penetrating the skin. So this is about the intercellular route. Let us move towards the transappendageal route. Again, understand the figure. So you will get here the idea about the various routes. So here, this is the transcellular route, and these are the corneocytes, isn't it? And this is the intercellular route, which makes the tortoise pathway for movement of drug from superficial layer, from the surface into the systemic circulation. And these are the transappendageal route, isn't it? Through which the drug, it is going to be permeated via the skin. So the transappendageal route involves the passage of molecules through the sweat glands and across the hair follicle. It occupies approximately 0.1% of surface area of the human skin. As I have said that the surface area of human skin is approximately 2 meters square, isn't it? So the follicle number, opening diameter, and follicle volume are the important considerations in the drug delivery through these appendages. Then these routes avoid penetration through the stratum corneum, as already previously we have discussed. These routes avoid penetration through the stratum corneum and therefore known as the shunt route or the shunt pathway. As when the drug is permeated through the transappendageal route, the main barrier, that is stratum corneum, which is absent. And that's why it is said to be the shunt pathway. Mainly, water-soluble substances are diffused faster through the appendages than that of the other layer. So mainly water-soluble drugs These are going to be absorbed or permeated through the transappendageal. So this is about the mechanism of dermal penetration of drug. Moving towards the steps involved in the skin absorption of drug, various steps, just we will see in short the steps and kinetics. So the dissolution and release of drug from the formulation. Say for example, we have prepared the ointment. So drug is going to be dissolved and it is going to be released from the ointment. Then sorption by the stratum corneum. So the drug, it is going to be reached into the stratum corneum. Then partitioning of drug through the viable epidermis, that is stratum corneum into the viable epidermis, and uptake into the local capillary network and eventually the systemic circulation. Already we have seen the figure. So you may understand how the drug, it is going to be permeated through the skin. There is various steps involved in the absorption of drug through the skin. So the kinetics of drug permeation through skin, which is given as a diffusion of drug across the membrane, it is described by the Fick's first law of diffusion. So by using the Fick's first law of diffusion, it is possible to understand the kinetics of drug permeation. So it states that the flux, that is a J, so here is the J, flux of the compound at a given time and position is proportional to the differential concentration change, that is the DC, over a differential distance DT, that is a concentration gradient. So the flux, which is typically expressed in the microgram hour per centimeter square, that is J is equal to minus D, D is the diffusion coefficient, into DC by DT, DC by DT is the concentration gradient. So it is possible to understand the kinetics of drug permeation by considering the Fick's first law of diffusion. That is a J flux is equal to minus D DC by DT. The rate of permeation across the skin, that is a DQ by DT, it is furthermore given by the equation, that is a DQ by DT, that is the rate of permeation is equal to P CD minus CR. So the P is the permeability coefficient. Then the CD and CR are the concentration of the skin penetrant in the donor compartment, that is the stratum corneum, CD, that is stratum corneum, and CR, that is in the body. So furthermore, the P, that is a permeability coefficient, can be determined by using the formula P is equal to dK divided by L. L is the thickness, K is the partition coefficient, and D is the diffusion coefficient. Two important things are there. Very first one, that is Fick's first law of diffusion, states that J is equal to minus D, DC upon DT. And the second equation, that is the permeability, determination of permeability, that is rate of permeation, that is dq by dt is equal to p cd minus cr. Cd is the stratum corneum and cr is the concentration of drug in the body, right? So in this way, it is possible to understand the kinetics of the drug permeation through the. So herewith we have finished the mechanism of dermal penetration of drug. Let us see the factors affecting to dermal penetration. So there are two important factors are there. That is the site specific factors and the drug specific factors. Site specific factors are furthermore divided into the site of application, then the race, age of the skin, skin condition, hydration, blood circulation to the skin, skin temperature, and skin metabolism. And drug specific factors are furthermore, that is the solubility of drug, then the partition coefficient, molecular weight, ionization, hydrogen bonding, melting point, and drug concentration. So we'll see one by one all these factors related with the site specific and drug specific, how these factors are going to affect the permeation of a drug through the. The very first one, that is the site of application. Whether the all over the body, the thickness of skin, it is same? No, it is not the same. It is going to differ. If the thickness is going to change, definitely the permeability of drug through the skin, it is going to be changed according to thickness. Either the permeability, it is going to be increased or it is going to be decreased. So the thickness of skin, it is one of the factor. Then the nature of stratum corneum, whether all over the body, the nature of stratum corneum, it is same. No, it is going to differ. The density of appendages at the various site, which are going to vary site to site. So whatever the density of these appendages, it is going to be vary from site to site. So depending on that, the permeability of drug into the skin, it is going to be changed. So these factors affect the penetration of drug through the skin. Say, for example, forehead shows more drug permeation than the arms and the abdomen. Suppose we have applied the drug on the palms and drug on the hands. Whether both areas having the same permeability? No. It is going to differ. The thickness of a skin on the palm, it is somewhat thicker. So the permeability is less, isn't it? So this is about the site of application. So we will move towards the next factor, that is a race. So there is a racial difference which is going to affect the permeability of the drug. In the black skin, the intracellular cohesion is more. And in the white, that is the white skin, the lipid content is more, isn't it? So the lipophilic drugs are more permeable in the white, simply, isn't it? So the racial difference, again, it is going to affect the permeability of the drug. The next factor, that is the age of the skin. When we are comparing the age, say, for example, children, then the healthy volunteer and the elderly person. Whether all of them have the same type of skin? No, it is going to change, isn't it? Maybe the skin which is present on the children, it is a thinner, isn't it? So drugs are going to be permeate rapidly in the children's skin. So the young skin is more permeable than the older skin. So in the older skin, hydration, blood flow, and enzyme activity, which is going to be reduced. If the hydration is going to be affected, definitely the permeability is going to be changed. If the blood flow, it is going to be changed, permeability is going to be changed. If enzyme activity is going to be affected, again, indirectly, it is going to affect the permeability of drug through the. Let us see the next factor, that is known as the skin condition. Say, for example, we have applied the drug on the damaged skin or wound. The permeability is more because stratum corneum is absent, absolutely absent, isn't it? On the scratched skin. So the disease conditions such as a psoriasis, then the eczema, then rashes, dermatitis, which increases the skin permeation due to compromised stratum corneum. Maybe you have seen the psoriatic patient. Then the hydration. So the hydrated skin shows more permeability to the drug. When we are using the humectants, so humectants are the hydrating agent. They are going to increase the permeability of the drug to the skin. Then generally we are using the hydrocarbon base. That is the oily, you can say the oily bases. For example, petroleum jelly, which increases the skin temperature and hydration by forming the occlusive film which promotes the skin permeation. Do you got the point? Then blood circulation to the skin. There are certain organic solvents are there which are going to promote the, or which are going to increase the blood circulation to the skin by vasodilation. They are going to act as a vasodilator and thereby promotes the blood flow towards the skin and increases the permeability of the drug. Then the skin temperature. So increase in skin temperature causes structural alteration in the stratum corneum and underlying tissue, and which increases the permeability of drug. If we are increasing the temperature of skin, automatically the structure of stratum corneum, it is going to be changed, and which promotes the permeation of drug through the skin. And the last factor from the site specific factor, that is the skin metabolism. There are certain enzymes which are present on the skin which are responsible for the metabolism of drugs like steroids, hormones, chemical carcinogens, and some drugs. So the drug permeability, that is the permeability of these drugs, are going to be reduced due to the metabolism, isn't it? So this is about the site specific factor. Let us move towards the drug specific factor. So the drug specific factors are furthermore divided into the drug solubility, drug partition coefficient, drug molecular weight, then the ionization, hydrogen bonding, melting point, and the drug concentration, right? So very first one, that is the solubility. Do you feel that the solubility is one of the criteria which needs to be considered for designing of the semi-solid formulations? As we know that the stratum corneum, it is a lipophilic in nature and which favors the permeation of lipophilic drug. If the drug is lipophilic in nature, automatically this lipophilic drug, it is going to be dissolved well into the stratum corneum and thereby it is going to be absorbed. So beneath layers of a stratum corneum, some layers are present which are hydrophilic in nature. So the drug should have the sufficient hydrophilicity as well as the lipophilicity. Are you getting me? Drug should have the biphasic solubility, then and then only it is going to be absorbed well or permeated well through the skin. The next factor, that is known as the partition coefficient. If the drug is having a high partition coefficient, it remains in the stratum corneum. High partition coefficient means these drugs are highly lipophilic in nature. So they are having the highest affinity towards the stratum corneum and which are going to be retained into the stratum corneum for longer period of time. See, if the drug is having a low partition coefficient, it will not be permeated. Karan pahila layer stratum corneum cha ahe ani jar techi jar hydrophilicity jast asel tar te lipophilic ja layers asnar ahe ti cross karel ka te drug karel ka nahi karnar mhanje permeation he honar nahi. So the drug should have the optimum partition coefficient. Ideally, log P value should be ranging between 1 to 4. So this is about the partition coefficient. Let us see the molecular weight. So the drug permeation, it is inversely related to molecular weight. Small molecule penetrate faster rate than the larger one. Drugs with a molecular weight greater than 500 Dalton are difficult to penetrate through the stratum corneum, isn't it? Means drug should have the low molecular weight in order to penetrate through the skin. Generally, it should be less than 500 Dalton. So this is about the molecular weight. Let us see the ionization. So the ionized drug crosses the skin barrier via shunt pathway, that is through the appendages, whereas the unionized drug pass well through the intracellular route or other routes which prefers the means unionized drug, it is going to cross the skin barrier by the intracellular route. Via ionized drug prefers the shunt pathway. Means generally, drug should be in the unionized state. Then and then only it is going to be permeated well through the skin. Then the hydrogen bonding, as the skin comprises the lipids. Yes, whether lipids are present in the skin? Yes. Proteins? Yes, proteins are present. Then aqueous regions? Yes, aqueous regions are also present. Enzymes? Some enzymes are present. We have not discussed the enzyme, but some enzymes are present. And the drug are either acidic or basic in nature. Acidic, basic, or ionized or unionized, or neutral in nature. So the drug may form hydrogen bonds or weak van der Waals forces, and which reduces the skin penetration. Are you getting me? As I have said that the skin comprises the proteins, aqueous regions, lipids, enzymes, and drugs which are either acidic, basic, ionized, or unionized. So there may be the chances of interaction between the drug and the skin component, isn't it? And thereby, which reduces the permeability of drug to the skin. Then the melting point, it is yet another parameter related with the drug. So drug with a high melting point and high enthalpy of melting have a low aqueous solubility, and low melting point, that is less than 200 degrees Celsius, drug may have high permeation through the skin. Means generally, whatever selected drug is there, it should have the melting point less than 200 degrees Celsius. Then and then only it is going to be permeated well through the skin. Then the drug concentration is the last parameter from the drug specific factor. So already we have discussed the flux, and flux is directly proportional to the concentration gradient, isn't it? J is equal to minus D, dc upon dt. So the flux is proportional to the concentration gradient across the barrier, and drug dose should be less than 10 milligrams. So herewith we have finished the factors influencing dermal drug penetration. We have discussed the site-specific factors, and we have discussed the drug-specific factors. So I herewith declare that the today's session is over. Thank you very much.